do you compare a cut-up street cruiser to a retro cafe racer, considering that both motorcycles are as similar to each other as apples are to brinjals? The KTM 390 is a modern motorcycle on the cutting edge of design and technology with ABS and an exposed frame, while the Royal Enfield Continental GT is a modern enough single-cylinder brute and yet looks like something your granddad would ride if he was cool. On paper, the KTM has the Enfield beat hands down because on paper, numbers and figures are flat and one-dimensional. On the road though, things are quite different. Because motorcycles are just not about numbers and figures, what a bike feels like when you ride it is very important. But even more important is how it makes you feel. Representing brash modernity is the KTM 390. The Duke looks like a motorcycle that was designed by someone with a pathological hatred for curves. Outside of the wheels, you're not going to find anything on this bike that's not a straight line. It's almost as if the Duke was designed for radar absorption. On the left-hand corner is the Continental GT, and it's unlike anything you will see out there on the roads in India. Clip-on handlebars, huge modern disc brakes from Brembo, a low-down riding position and a single seat. Under that seat, you won't find a water-cooled parallel or a V-twin. What you've got is a big single cylinder that wouldn't look out of place on a motorcycle from the 60s.
Now this motorcycle might look a little weird to your 21st century eye, a bit like a mashup between a sports bike and a single-cylinder vintage British motorcycle. And in a strange way, that's exactly what it is. And so Royal Enfield, with their huge appreciation for the past, has modernized the cafe racer concept, bringing it to the 21st century. Because kids these days, they're bored with sexting and Twitter. They want to play, and this right here is a great toy. Under me is a 535cc single cylinder air-cooled engine that's putting out 29 bhp and 44 newtons of torque.
Now considering it's supposed to be a sporty bike, the GT is not especially fast, not in the monstrous way a modern 500cc motorcycle will be, but fast enough when you're riding around in its natural habitat, the city. Yet this motorcycle will hit 100 pretty quickly and seems capable enough for you to stay there all day. What we didn't enjoy so much were the vibrations, especially at lower speeds, but it smooths out as soon as you hit the higher gears. What you will enjoy is the soundtrack this engine provides. This is a quick revving engine, and unlike other RE motorcycles, the exhaust is less thump and more rip.
Now you will find yourself revving this bike constantly, even at slow speeds, if nothing then just to entertain and amuse yourself and innocent bystanders. Now attached to this engine is a 5-speed smooth shifting gearbox. And let me tell you, in the 400 odd kilometers I rode this bike, I have not even got one false shift.
What you will also appreciate about this motorcycle is the way it handles. This is the best handling Royal Enfield ever built, and coming from a brand of motorcycles known for their stability, this is high praise. Adding to the overall sense of well-being is the huge 300mm Brembo disc brake in the front, along with a 240mm one in the rear.
A word of warning though, this is not a bike designed for long-distance riding, but rather for short, sharp urban trips. Now the thing is that the forward-leaning position and the narrow contoured seats are going to conspire to wreck both your wrists and your ass if you attempt anything more than 100 kilometers in a shot.
Now considering that the Continental GT is a recreation of motorcycles from the 60s, attention to detail is going to matter hugely, and this is where Royal Enfield mostly succeed. In this day and age of graphics and cowls and bikini fairings, the Continental GT is a stylish yet honest motorcycle. People will look at you as you ride past. The KTM, on the other hand, unlike the Continental GT, is a frantic, excitable motorcycle, one that will set your pants on fire.
0 to 60 in 2.5 seconds, sure, no problem. 0 to 100 in second gear without even breaking a sweat. Looking to cruise at 130 kilometers on the highway? Yep, you can do that in fifth gear. You've got an extra gear in your coin purse just in case you want to go extra zen. And all that because power. What you've got under me is a 374cc four-stroke liquid-cooled engine, putting out 44 bhp on a frame chassis that's borrowed straight from the 200. What that means is that power flows from this engine like rice at a Chinese wedding. Death sledgehammer like power in the mid-range and for the heavy breathers among you. For those of you who must know, this bike redlines at 10,500 RPM. And since it's pretty cool, it's also got a big red shift indicator right in the center of the console. Because constantly hitting the red limiter is not cool. Now helping you along on your merry way is a 6-speed gearbox, which feels light and notchy and is diametrically opposed to the one you found in the 200, whereas that was frantic and begged, almost pleaded with you to shift. This one is geared so tall. Now considering you've got all this power, you can happily cruise around in third gear, especially in traffic, which is genius because it allows you to accelerate and deaccelerate, to burst out and grab a lane without any problems. Then there's the way this bike handles. With a combination of a riot of an engine and gearbox, the 390 just begs you to be naughty with it. Now if you're jumping onto this bike from any other in its class, you're gonna have to wait for a few corners to get the hang of it, because everything happens so razor sharp and so quickly that it's gonna take you some time to figure it out. But once you do, you will be rewarded. Hit a bad patch of road and your ass, as the Americans say, will be grass. Because this is a street bike through and through, designed to navigate through city boulevards. Now if you are riding a little long distance on a road that's not especially great, your back and rear end will suffer. But then the wide saddle allows you to move a little bit, allows you to shift your weight around.
And then there's the price, the only area where both motorcycles are in accord. Both will cost you in the vicinity of 2 plus lakh rupees, depending on where you live. And if you wanted a definitive answer to what bike you should get, it all depends on what your state of mind is. The Continental GT might seem slow, but then we all know that speed is relative. When you're riding around in the city, this is where the GT is in its natural habitat. It feels quick, if you can abide by all the vibrations. The KTM, on the other hand, is much quicker, better in every other way. But where it falls short is style. Sadly, this motorcycle looks identical to the 200, and if preening is part of your motorcycle process, then the KTM will let you down. Now, personally, I'd pick the 390, but that's just me. If you look good in leather, then the Continental GT will work for you. We're moving on now. Here's all the news from Planet Auto. The biggest and most important auto event this week took place not at a launch in a five-star lobby or the racetrack, but in the hallowed halls of Parliament, as the Finance Minister P. Chidambaram slashed the excise duties for automobiles in the interim budget. Duties cut from 12 to 8% for small cars, two-wheelers and commercial vehicles, from 24 to 20% for mid-size sedans, and from 30 to 24% for SUVs. To their credit, automakers across the board have passed on the savings to the customer. On the high end of the spectrum, Mercedes reduced the price of the C-Class Avant-Garde Edition from 39.9 lakhs to 39.3 lakh rupees. The flagship GLS SUV will also cost 2 lakh rupees less. Competing with the GL will be the Q7 from Audi, whose prices have also dropped for the top-end variant by 3 lakhs. The top-end Mammoth SUV will now cost 78.2 lakhs, down from 82.1. Nissan has passed on the excise cut to its customers by dropping the prices of the Micra Active and the Sunny, which will be cheaper by 4%, while the Terrano gets a 6% price cut. Hyundai have reduced prices for all its cars across the board, with cuts ranging from 10,000 rupees for its small hatches all the way up to 1.35 lakhs for the top-end Santa Fe SUV. Prices of the Scorpio, Bolero and XUV500 dropped by between 13 and 49,000 rupees, while prices of the SsangYong Rexton SUV saw a cut of 92,000. Honda cut the prices of its cars from the Brio all the way up to the CR-V in a range of 14,650 to 44,741 rupees. VW too reacted quickly to the finance minister's statements, reducing prices of the Polo from 18 to 31,000, the Vento by 14.5 to 27,000 and the Jetta by 38 to 51,000 rupees.